The Movie Preview Critic. Informing and entertaining your movie world.
Welcome to the first preview review of 2010. Usually I start off pre-reads by editing the preview and analyzing it. But in the case of Marmaduke, yes, I'm reviewing Marmaduke. Let's take a look at the 35-second teaser trailer.
Being a teenager can be rough. Trying to fit in, who's cool, who's not. But if the world doesn't fit you, you're totally hosed. California. Try being a 200-pound teenage dog in a radar dish.
Ah!
Try being a 200-pound teenage dog.
Ah! The Movie Preview Critic rates Marmaduke unworthy. Wait, hold on. It's unfair to rate it like that, right? As much as I want to take a corn-studded, peanut-riddled, steaming-stinking critical on this, it wouldn't be right without taking a deeper, objective look at...
You're totally hosed.
Excuse me for a moment. I've been doing some soul-searching, trying to answer why does this movie exist? The cynical, obvious movie business answer is, because Marmaduke is a comic strip created in 1954 that's still running today, and it possesses something that Nike, McDonald's, and Lady Gaga all have, name recognition. Is any person named Marmaduke anymore? I'm not knocking it, I actually like it in a hipster kind of way. When you think of Toyota, you imagine dependable foreign-made cars that rarely ever break down. When you hear Marmaduke, all you think is... a talking funny dog. That's gold when you want to sell something. And following in the tradition of the 2K Zeros, the movie train to box office easy profit town is pulling out, and Marmaduke is at the controls, this head out the window with tongue wagging. Now, to be clear, I'm not against adaptations, remakes, or reboots as a whole. Silence of the Lambs was a book. The Fly from the 80s was a remake of the 1950s version. And I prefer Christopher Nolan's rebooted Batman to Tim Burton's. The key factor is quality. Is there creative energy, inspiration, and a joyous storytelling motivation fueling a film's existence, or is the audience being squeezed for every last box office cent before cultural fad dries out and people lose interest in it? Here, it seems like the latter. But let's take a look at the filmmaking talent involved and discover if any kind of effort has been put forth. Here, Owen Wilson is the voice of the title character, which seems a little sad. Is his career already at that let's make movies with cute dogs for easy money point? He did go through some emotional turmoil a few years back, so maybe making kids movies has created some healing, which all dog lovers can agree that having man's best friend as a companion can be nurturing to the soul, but not as strong as the healing power of 6 or 7 zeros on a paycheck. This has a large cast with a lot of recognizable names, but because this is a teaser trailer, we don't get to see them in voiceover action. But I'm not going to wait for the full preview to bestow judgment here. We all know this will follow the Disney rulebook of how to make the audience love talking animals. Each one has a unique personality with a corresponding voice actor that personifies that attitude. Here, Marmaduke is moving to California, a strange dog in a strange land. He'll make new friends, probably fall in love, but first have to solve a neighborhood problem. Maybe a tough bulldog on the block, or help his human owner overcome some mundane issue like getting a promotion or winning a girl over. There's something about talking canine that never gets old. Probably because we love our pets sometimes more than we love other humans. And for many, having a talking dog would be a dream come true. A dream as old as the movies. Take a look at a clip of MGM's Dogville comedy series, which was in production between 1929 and 1931.
Honey, how about a little kid?
I think.
The door is locked, and you can't get out.
Oh, help! Don't you come near me! Oh, help! Help!
It's like videos of cute kittens on the internet. There's something in our genes. Something that scientists have yet to discover, like the stupid video-watching gene 2RB-9 that predisposes individuals to impulsively watching the Only the offspring of Ebenezer Scrooge and Cruella de Vil would hate something like this, right? Somewhere inside us is that little kid who just can't help laugh and smile at this kind of material. But is that inner kid wise enough to choose if these kind of movies deserve our hard-earned money at the box office? Probably not. That's why the adult in us has to factor in two more elements before deciding to see this. It's written by Tim Rasmussen, a newcomer to the screenwriting world whose only credits include License to Wed and Smother. It's directed by Tom Day, whose resume consists of Shanghai Noon, Showtime, and Failure to Launch. And then there's the preview, which has kind of a bipolar quality. On the one hand, it's cliche with the music choice and the surprise setup. Wide shot with the OC theme song. Voiceover that seems to belong to a human teenager moving to a new home. Then bang, the twist. It's a f***ing dog. Aw, that's cute and funny. And the music changes to a little classic hip-hop. Oh, and where are they going? California. And let's make sure we understood that. California. Wow, that's so great. They found two songs that have the word California. You could spend all day listing the warning signs. But just to be brief. Number 6, the movie uses the same old jokes we've seen before. Number 22, you've seen this before and it's been done better. Number 27, after viewing the preview, you ask, is this a straight-to-DVD movie? Number 29, it's obvious the actors are in it for a paycheck. Number 31, it's not better than what's on TV or cable. Number 36, you're laughing at the preview for all the wrong reasons. Number 41, the director's not having an impressive resume. And number 78, the preview is overstating the importance of an actor's presence in a movie. Check this out. What happened? Was Ben Stiller busy, or did he just throw his actor friend a bone? Yes, pun intended. Is anybody sitting there really thinking, Owen Wilson's playing Marmaduke? I gotta get my ticket now. Marmaduke could have been voiced by John Nobody, and it wouldn't matter. We're gonna see this because it's a talking dog. Who cares who's in it? Though I will say that if it said this, I might have been swayed to check it out a little more. Or maybe even this. Despite all this negativity, there is some potential here. Hidden in this theme is a hint of a coming-of-age story.
Being a teenager can be rough. Trying to fit in, who's cool, who's not.
He's a teenager, and the visuals actually symbolize the internal struggle. He talks about not fitting into the world, and it's represented by him not fitting into the car. That's actually kind of impressive. Marmaduke is kind of being set up to be the canine version of Juno, of a teen trying to find his or her place in the world. Let's imagine for a second, what if this was directed by Jason Reitman, or someone from Pixar, or maybe even Darren Aronofsky, or Christopher Nolan? Okay, that sounds crazy. But imagine that, Marmaduke, a Coen Brothers film. The minute you add quality filmmakers to an idea, it transforms it, because we know they have vision and are in touch with their humanity so they can share it with us and create the characters through that. Or this is just a talking f***ing dog movie. It'll be cute, fun, and silence 2 to 8 year olds for 90 minutes. There is such a thing as just seeking entertainment at the movies, as was brilliantly broken down by prolific comedy director Preston Sturges back in the 1930s and 40s, when he revealed his secret of movie making. It seems like Tom Day has read this before, because we get our landscape soon replaced by a dog. Expect kittens, babies, and pratfalls to follow, because that's what you want here. This subgenre of talking dog kids films is like its main character. Faithful, reliable, lazy, predictable, and taking a crap on the big screen for 90 minutes. But because we love our dogs, we have plastic bags in hand ready to scoop it up. The movie preview critic rates Marmaduke unworthy of big screen viewing for most of humanity. See it as a rental. There's nothing here that's big screen worthy. You'll see it for the cutesiosity factor. It exists because of studio market research, which predicts a ka-ching easy payday. It's predictable and cliche. You react to the preview by saying, get the out of here. Is this really a movie? Did the studio think an audience would pay to see this? You know what you're getting. It's the same old mainly because it's a family movie, and it's definitely a sign of the movie apocalypse. For our box office prediction, currently budget numbers aren't available, but let's assume it cost between 50 to 70 million. With a release date of June 4th, the week before A-Team Karate Kids, 2 weeks before Toy Story 3, and a little over 3 weeks before the next Twilight. So this is gonna make 90% of its money opening weekend and disappear from theaters. But even that won't be that much, because parents will figure, let's wait for Toy Story 3 to take the kids out. So look for an opening weekend of maybe 10 million and a theatrical run of 25. If it makes any more than that, the movie apocalypse is closer than we think. As for Marmaduke's place in movie history, it should be better than Garfield 2, but not better than the original Garfield or even Beverly Hills Chihuahua. Until next time, choose your movies wisely, because Story Corp gives us more of what we pay for, and as always,
long live good movies!